is a Fox 5 News special honoring Black history.
How you doing? And welcome to our special honoring Black history, mind, body, soul. I'm Pastor Miles with The Rock Church, and we're happy you're here with us in honor of Black History Month, where we're taking a look at some of the accomplishments African Americans have had here in San Diego and across America. We begin with Fox 5's Liberty Zabala, who has an inspirational story of how one San Diego nonprofit is helping to inspire and motivate young Black girls.
Hello, everybody. We are on our way to mountain biking.
What started as a breakfast talk for foster sisters in Southeast San Diego is now a thriving leadership academy for girls of color, known as DTOR.
DTOR is my love letter to the community.
DTOR stands for Depositing Empowerment Through Outreach and Urban Development, and helps girls develop self-esteem, self-love, and self-empowerment.
My confidence, it just went up, and it really gave me like the boost I needed. And I'm more involved in my community than ever. I really feel like I'm just a part of something special.
Tanisa Conright's goal is to make sure these girls have big sisters to help them through the challenges of life and home.
You don't see a lot of traditional households. You may have girls that are being raised by grandmother, aunt, you know, foster parents even. Right, so that's the one issue. And then two, and primarily in communities of color, girls have to take on more responsibility at a younger age.
She knows these struggles well because she's been through it.
That was my story, right? So I'm the oldest of my many siblings. There's so many. And my mom had to depend on me when she went to work.
Tanisa learned how to mentor her foster sisters and would go on to mentor more than 1,000 girls through her academy. She teaches them life skills and lessons that they wouldn't otherwise be exposed to.
Talk about, you know, healthy communication, healthy relationships, mental health, surviving high school, surviving college.
But her program, known as FANCY, or Focused and Naturally Confident Youth, teaches them they have what it takes to succeed in college and at their future careers.
We've done a lot of robotics camps. We've visited big places like solar turbines and just amazing things like that around the city. And it's definitely been way better than I could have ever expected. And when I first joined, I had no idea that I would even have the chance to do half of the things that I've done.
The Academy exposes them to charity work, STEAM education, outdoor activities, and gives them a place to learn, grow, and serve.
I joined a sport. I started my own business.
Tanisa's love letter to the community are the hundreds of young sisters who come out of DTOR truly accepting themselves and ready to give back to the world.
Leaving something better than you saw it or better than it started is it's a good way to leave the world to me.
Being able to at least try and help subtract the amount of violence in the world.
If you put the work in, you can definitely just accomplish your dreams.
Now the girls meet here one night a week from September through June for the FANCY program, and DTOR hopes to one day be able to expand their programs to help girls all over the world. For now in Southeast San Diego, Liberty Zabala, Fox 5 News.
Now to a story to an NFL player who stepped forward to shine a light on an issue that lingers in the darkness. As Bob Donaldson shows us, an Indianapolis Colts player has become the face of his team's effort to end the stigma surrounding mental illness.
There's a reason they call him the Maniac. Even for an NFL player, Darius Leonard is high energy. The Indianapolis Colts linebacker is a highly paid All-Pro, his team is a contender, and he's devoted to his family. On the surface, it all seems perfect.
Everybody only see the happy part of me. You know, everybody only see me dancing, having a good time, you know, enjoying my family. But people don't understand that, you know, behind closed doors, that, you know, things are not what people make it seem to be.
Darius Leonard has, maybe surprisingly, become the face of the Colts' Kicking the Stigma campaign, the team's effort to raise awareness about mental health. Leonard has used his own painful experience as an example of how many people suffer in silence. He came forward about his bouts of depression and anxiety after his brother was killed in a nightclub fight when they were teenagers. He sought counseling after suffering for years.
I was once that kid who didn't have anything. I was once that kid who felt like, you know, his back was against the wall and nobody was there for him.
I struggled for a long time.
The Colts asked Leonard to share his mental health journey in a series of Kicking the Stigma public service announcements aired on national TV. He admits he seems like an unlikely spokesman.
Going through all the adversity that I've been through, being the top level linebacker that I am, and people think that I'm just living on in high heaven right now, which is not true. You know, just going through all the depression and things that other people go through.
Who's ready to shot?
Me.
Leonard is also among the most active Colts in the Indianapolis community. It gives him many opportunities to share his mental health history with fans young and old. The Colts ownership says they couldn't have found a better ambassador to spread their important message.
I think people in that role of being a role model and being, you know, especially like a football player, you know, you're tough and you're out on the field, you know, and he's someone who's so too, like, happy-go-lucky and, you know, goofy and so such a positive light, but yet, you know, he has these personal struggles.
The rest of the Colts have embraced the team's mission of kicking the stigma. Leonard says even some of his teammates have been surprised to hear about his struggle and his honesty about it. The Colts linebacker has reached them and countless others who otherwise would have suffered like he did.
You're not trying to reach everybody, you're just trying to reach that one person to say, okay, you're having the same problem as your role model. And if your role model can step up and say, you know, I need help, you can do the same thing.
In Indianapolis, Bob Donaldson reporting.
Coming up on Honoring Black History, Mind, Body, Soul. Faith in churches. During a time when COVID was tearing us apart, many came together to find healing in church. And hitting the right notes. It's not always the game that gets us excited, but the marching bands, it's a long legacy. Next.
This is a Fox 5 News special honoring Black history. Now return to Honoring Black History.
Welcome back. I'm Miles McPherson. There's perhaps been no greater hit to the Black community in recent history than the COVID pandemic that's been especially hard for minorities. Many have turned to the one institution they trusted the most, the church. Elliot Davis reports on how it met the needs of African American communities around the country.
In African-American churches all across America, people come for help during this pandemic, dealing with mental stress, struggling with the body's physical needs, and to spiritually strengthen them to withstand the terrible losses brought on by COVID.
Now, God, we pray for our families that are grieving. We pray for those that are in hospital rooms.
Reverend Charles Norris is pastor of St. James AME Church. He's also president of the St. Louis Metropolitan Clergy Coalition.
What made the Black church uniquely able to fill this role?
First, presence. The fact that we were there. We've always been there. We already had the relationship. And you really can't speak to people on a soul level without having a significant relationship there already.
Another church with that same relationship is Faith Miracle Temple. They too had to make quick changes in the pandemic to keep up with the needs of the hurting community. Smaller praise and worship groups have taken the place of big choirs because of COVID protocols. There are stringent COVID checks just to get in the church. Smaller crowds attend because of COVID social distancing.
Bless the offering that you gave today.
More online and live streaming at churches like this that were shut down to in-person services. Bishop Larry Baylor admits a few unwanted drawbacks.
Now, people are so used to staying at home on Sunday with a cappuccino in their hand, with their pajamas on, watching the service and get back in bed. I've done so many funerals over the last roughly 2 years. It has been incredible. First of all, the church deals with the spiritual aspect of people. Now, because you are a pastor, you deal with the mental aspect of people. And then it's our responsibility as well to make sure that everybody has food, make sure everybody has a roof over their head.
How important has the church been for you in this COVID pandemic?
It has been very instrumental in my faith. Hard times, I'm a nurse, so just give me strength and endurance.
Even political leaders like this mayor from Vernita Park, Missouri, agrees.
I think the black church been a pillar of this community. When we needed the testing, they was behind us. When we needed the vaccine, they was behind us.
So the black church is the most trusted institution in the African-American community. And with all the unknowns of COVID, trust is in high demand for a community hit hard by COVID, a community where people needed some place to come, where they knew they'd be serviced, mind, body, and soul. In St. Louis, Elliot Davis reporting.
Next on Honoring Black History, Mind, Body, Soul, the barbershop. We know it's a lot more than just getting a fresh cut. The barbershop chair turns into a therapy chair as mental health comes to the forefront. Coming up, cutting confessions.
This is a Fox 5 News special, Honoring Black History. Return to Honoring Black History.
Welcome back. COVID-19 has brought mental health front and center, especially in the black community. A major hospital in Arkansas receives a multi-million dollar grant to go into barbershops and talk to men about their emotional well-being. Donna Terrell explains.
It's trim day at the barbershop, but here, a sharp line or fade comes with much more than a dope cut.
Oh, you got me looking like $1 million.
Through a program called the Confess Project, licensed barbers are trained to be mental health champions for black men less likely to see a therapist.
Barbershop is, for us as African-American men, one of our safe places.
And it's in the barber's chair that clients get a fresh look designed with mental healing.
In a lot of places, even maybe at work or sometimes even at home, I might feel uncomfortable to express myself in certain ways. And so when I come to the barbershop, I can just relax and just talk about pretty much anything.
I know personally I've been fighting depression and anxiety for about 15 years.
92 Jams, the big station, your man Stack 3 is in the house right now.
Radio personality Houston Stackhouse speaks openly about mental health.
Just try to stay positive, try to keep pushing. So we all got to do.
He too finds support through his barber trained by the Confess Project.
I'm able to come in, just relax and just let everything just go.
Hey, so I'm Lorenzo Lewis from Little Rock, Arkansas, and I run an organization called the Confess Project.
Organization founder and Arkansas native Lorenzo Lewis had his own mental health issues.
It started with just my story of my own depression and really has evolved to becoming a national movement.
A movement of more than 1,000 barbers in 15 states, trained how to listen, detect problems, and guide clients to professional help if needed.
Our barbers are peer intervention specialists, I like to call it. They're advocates on the front line. And they're really supporting someone through a conversation, which could really lead to true impact and a true quality of life change.
It's tough getting black men, though, to the therapist, right?
It is, absolutely.
According to the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, in 2019, suicide was the second leading cause of death for African Americans between the ages of 15 and 24. And suicide for black men was four times higher than for black women.
Like you can say, it's a grooming process, you know what I mean?
Taiwan Dickerson has been a barber since 1998. With the help of the Confess Project and other mental health training, he has more than barber tools to provide help and resources. And he's not afraid to ask tough questions.
Did we ever reach out for help? Did we ever, you know, are you open?
So you'll ask them?
Yeah, I would ask them.
Point blank, how many actually say, yes, I have?
Yes, I have several. I have several.
He tells me one of his clients was admitted to a mental health facility after he convinced him to get help.
That was a good, awesome moment because I felt like he was at his breaking point. He felt like he was about to just give up on life.
Resistance to mental health treatment?
It's connected to shame and guilt. A lot of it, with, particularly with black men, is black men have so much of the stoicism to live up to, of being strong and powerful. And truly when, you know, I think when we break through and understand that this is about us getting our power and getting the control of our life.
And can leave a positive effect on an entire family just by spending an hour or so getting shaped up and brushed off. In Little Rock, Arkansas.
All right, thank you, sir.
Donna Terrell reporting.
Making sweet music on the field. It's what pumps us up at the games. The history and legacy of marching bands. Next on Honoring Black History, Mind, Body, and Soul.
This is a Fox 5 News special, Honoring Black History. This is a Fox 5 News special, Honoring Black History.
At historically black colleges and universities, the marching band often steals the show. While people come for the football games, it's the halftime show that really cements the experience. Rod Carter, give us a look.
Whether it's the fast pace of the sound machine at North Carolina Central University,
thank you for joining us here today,
or the slow, methodical snake walk of the famed Marching 100 at Florida A&M,
let's go. Hey, turn up.
Or perhaps the platinum sound of Shaw University, the pageantry of marching bands at historically black colleges and universities is something that cannot be duplicated.
They leave it all on the field.
Even Pepsi sees and knows that with the recent release of this commercial called The Halftime Game.
It's like none other, right? I mean, like, you want to strike up the band if you're a football player.
ESPN HBCU color analyst and Florida A&M grad Tiffany Green knows that experience firsthand. She sees it every Saturday in the fall while she calls the action on the gridiron.
It's the soundtrack for the football game. So there is no football game without a band.
She knows for many, the halftime show really is the true attraction.
I would argue that they are equally as important as the football team.
At North Carolina Central.
Coming in freshman year, that's my first time marching.
When it comes to the sound machine, drum majors Donnell Troy Jr. and Hassan Gaddy aren't playing around.
Being in the marching band, of course, you create more of a family aura. So when you're here, it's like, I actually feel like home.
The culture is very different. It's very fun to be in and just, you know, just have fun.
The band director, Thurman Hollins.
Marching band that was founded in 1938 on this campus.
Tells me the 130-plus piece band and its rich history really teach as much about life as it does music.
We represent the entire school all in one ensemble.
And when it comes to class, it's about striking that right chord for success.
That's like a part of the daily announcements, you know, go to class. We break them into actually clusters of students by major within the band too, so they can mentor each other and tutor each other.
For HBCUs like Shaw, the bands are really more than just an opportunity to fill the stands and get people all excited about a game and really just come have a good time. They really are sort of like educational Pied Pipers, if you will. They lure prospective students to come here to Shaw and other schools to keep that educational legacy going.
And that is on full display in this McDonald's commercial featuring a Shaw University grad and her son who marched in his mother's footsteps.
this is something that I never would have dreamt of.
Shaw's band director Andre King tells me the band and the football program went away until two decades ago.
Next year will be our 20th year anniversary here with bringing back football and marching band.
But like the commercial shows, band is a great way to attract students, both legacy and first timers alike, and cement a legacy.
It is a blessing.
In Raleigh, North Carolina, I'm Rod Carter.
Coming up on Honoring Black History, Mind, Body, Soul, Painting a Picture, we'll introduce you to a photographer who hopes to send a message with every snap she takes.
This is a Fox 5 News special, honoring Black history. This is a Fox 5 News special, honoring Black history.
She calls herself a hype woman.
One, two, and shooting.
Keisha Ward has snapped thousands of photos. She highlights the ins and outs of the Black experience. From woman empowerment to motherhood to celebrating love, Ward hopes her photos show the good, long-lasting love exists in every shot she takes. Thank you for joining us on Honoring Black History, Mind, Body, Soul. I'm Pastor Miles McPherson with The Rock Church.